Lectio Libri Genesis. Israel loved Joseph best of all his sons, for he was the child of his old age, and he had made him a long tunic. When his brothers saw that their father loved him best of all his sons, they hated him so much that they would not even greet him. One day, when his brothers had gone to pasture their father's flocks at Shechem, Israel said to Joseph, "Your brothers, you know, are tending our flocks at Shechem. Get ready. I will send you to them." So Joseph went after his brothers and caught up with them in Dothan. They noticed him from a distance, and before he came up to them, they plotted to kill him. They said to one another, "Here comes that master dreamer. Come on, let us kill him and throw him into one of the cisterns here. We could say that a wild beast devoured him. We shall then see what comes of his dreams." When Reuben heard this, he tried to save him from their hands, saying, "We must not take his life." Instead of shedding blood, he continued, "Just throw him into that cistern there in the desert, but do not kill him outright." His purpose was to rescue him from their hands and return him to his father. So when Joseph came up to them, they stripped him of the long tunic he had on. Then they took him and threw him into the cistern, which was empty and dry. They then sat down to their meal. Looking up, they saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead, their camels laden with gum, balm, and resin to be taken down to Egypt. Judah said to his brothers, "What is to be gained by killing our brother and concealing his blood? Rather, let us sell him to these Ishmaelites instead of doing away with him ourselves. After all, he is our brother, our own flesh." His brothers agreed. They sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver. Verbum Domini.
Thank you. Dominus vobiscum. Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Matteum. Jesus said to the chief priests and the elders of the people, "Hear another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a hedge around it, dug a winepress in it, and built a tower. Then he leased it to tenants and went on a journey. When vintage time drew near, he sent his servants to the tenants to obtain his produce. But the tenants seized the servants, and one they beat, another they killed, and a third they stoned. Again he sent other servants, more numerous than the first ones, but they treated them in the same way. Finally he sent his son to them, thinking, 'They will respect my son.' But when the tenants saw the son, they said to one another, 'This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and acquire his inheritance.' They seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. What will the owner of the vineyard do to those tenants when he comes?" They answered him, "He will put those wretched men to a wretched death and lease his vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the proper times." Jesus said to them, "Did you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. By the Lord has this been done, and it is wonderful in our eyes.' Therefore I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that will produce its fruit." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they knew that he was speaking about them. And although they were attempting to arrest him, they feared the crowds, for they regarded him as a prophet. Verbum Domini.
Those of us who have siblings might know something of sibling rivalry. There's always some dynamic going on of competition, sometimes even hatred or envy, things like that. Hopefully nothing that we've experienced in that regard compares to what Joseph went through with his brothers, as we heard in the first reading. It began, of course, with envy. All of his brothers were envious of the way their father loved him more than all of the rest of the brothers. But from that envy in their heart that just festered and grew. There came hatred. It said they wouldn't even greet him. They hated him so much. And then eventually they see this opportunity, as we heard, we'll kill him. Reuben tries to intervene. Let's just throw him in the cistern. And he intended to rescue him later, but then when this caravan approaches, as we heard, Judah has an even better idea. Why don't we sell him to them? Why kill him? We don't get anything. Here we can at least make some silver if we sell him to these, to this caravan, sell him into slavery. So we see that sin makes a pretty good showing here. Lots of different sins: envy, anger, greed. There's a kind of cowardice we see in Reuben as well. He doesn't have the courage to stand up to the rest of his brothers and say, no, we shouldn't do this. So sin makes a pretty good showing here. But you know what? In this reading, a deeper lesson is that Almighty God is almighty. That sounds pretty obvious. Almighty God is all-powerful. No matter how great a showing sin can make, sin can never thwart God's plan. God can even use our evil choices, despite the evil that's in our heart, and despite our evil actions. God can still work good, far beyond our imagining. We know the rest of the story. Joseph ends up a slave in Egypt, but because of his presence there, he's able to save the country from famine and save up enough food to save all the surrounding peoples from famine as well, including Israel and his brothers, Joseph's brothers. God is able to take this evil action and work good from it. That's God's omnipotence. He cannot be stopped. He cannot be thwarted, even by the worst we can put forward in terms of sin. The gospel goes along with this first reading then, because we see a similar dynamic in the parable. These wicked tenants show forth such wickedness, such hatred, such envy, such greed, all the same things we see in the brothers of Joseph, the sons of Israel, we see in these tenants in the parable. And yet Christ says, this psalm is fulfilled here. Did you never read in the scriptures, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. By the Lord has this been done, and it is wonderful in our eyes. We know that the worst of the murderous hatred humanity has to offer, the hatred that will put Christ, the Son of God, on the cross and kill him, it's through that God has worked our salvation. By the Lord has this been done, and it is wonderful in our eyes. Not the evil that has been done, no, but the fact that the stone rejected by the builders has become the cornerstone. By the Lord, this has been done. It's that despite our evil actions, despite the evil in our heart, God's plan cannot be thwarted. He is always victorious in the end. Even if it doesn't look like it in the middle of the story, God is always victorious in the end. This should give us great confidence, brothers and sisters. No matter what's going on in the world, God is in control. Everything is in his hands. But at the same time, it should prick our consciences because we want to be on his side. We want to be collaborators with God, friends of God, not those enemies of God that God can still work good through, but it won't end well for those enemies of God unless they repent and be converted. Hearing about the brothers of Joseph, hearing about the wicked tenants in this parable can alert us to the fact that evil, even when it begins in small ways in the heart, can wreak great havoc. And yes, it won't thwart the Lord's plan, but it has enormous destructive effects. including for those who commit the evil. We don't want to be those enemies of God. We want to be among his friends, those he calls to share in his mission.
gratias agens benedicit, delitque discipulis suis dicens. Accipite et vivite ex eo omnes. Hic est enim calix sanguinis mei, novi et eterni testamenti, qui pro vobis et pro multis effundetur, in remissionem peccatorum, hoc facite in meam commemorationem.
Perpetua Agatha Lucia Aliete